Hello, welcome to the self-learning podcast by Dr. Sushma Singh. Let us start discussion on block 3, contemporary perspectives, unit 9, comparative methods. Navigating with the core issues of the objective versus subjective, macro versus micro, and value neutrality versus partisanship. This unit refers to the relationship of comparative method with common sense and interrogates its ideological location. Next, as comparative method has its own distinct historical legacy and trajectory, the author has provided a discussion of the historical context within which the method emerged. The trajectory of the method is relevant to the way it is operationalized during the course of the empirical research. Further, there is a systematic delineation of key features of the method. Throughout the unit, there has been a focus on the linkages between the overall theoretical assumptions, research methods, and field techniques. There is also substantial reference to social science research carried out in India on comparative method, and this will provide us with a solid base in applying comparative method in our own research, because as said earlier, there can be no sociology without comparisons. This unit will provide us with some identifiable lessons for our own research on social concerns. Let us move to the point, relationship between the common sense interrogating ideological location. Students of sociology are well aware about both the distinction between the common sense and sociology, as well as the danger of collapsing sociological knowledge to common sense understanding. It is in this context of a discussion on the comparative approach that this allusion to common sense again becomes important. We are well aware that we use comparison and contrast in everyday life, and it is no wonder that application of compare and contrast in the study of human society and culture is also equally common. If we think about our day-to-day understanding of the social world around us, we would realize that we are involved in comparing and contrasting processes. In addition, all of us keep evaluating things, people, foods, cultures, etc., in terms of their inherent qualities being superior or inferior. It is quite commonplace to hear comments that our food is tastier than theirs, or that they have a more developed culture than ours. In the later statement, one detects an evolutionary assumption, meaning that there are stages of development and each successive stage is superior to the preceding one. For long in sociology, it seemed perfectly in order to compare the barbaric to the civilized or the primitive to the modern. Sociologists now more self-consciously use simple and complex societies to avoid the embedded value judgment that rests on an evolutionary comparative approach. Interestingly, however, there is also awareness, even at the everyday level, that comparisons are not nice and we ought to value each person, object, or idea for itself. We would notice that some themes of the comparative approach also make their presence within everyday notions. Indeed, the connection and spilling over of the two levels make it doubtfully difficult to distinguish the sociological approach to comparison and our own lay approach. Batley makes a careful and important distinction between the lay comparative and sociological comparative approaches. In his L.T. Hobhouse Memorial Trust Lecture 33, Evans Pritchard stressed the necessity of comparison and commented that in widest sense there is no other method. Comparison is of course one of the essential procedures of all science and one of the elementary processes of human thought. Evans Pritchard was echoing what Durkheim wrote. Comparative sociology is not a particular branch of sociology. It is sociology itself, so far as it ceases to be purely descriptive and aspires to account for facts. McFarlane wrote that a number of observers have noted that in order to understand one phenomena, one must place it in perspective or comparison to others. And quoted Louis, who put it thus: at the same time, a phenomena is understood only in relation to others. He little knows of England, who only England knows. Hence, it is well to look at the Western culture in perspective. Most social scientists are generally aware that they are involved in comparison all the time, as McFarlane has put it. In the case of history, the comparisons are usually in time. In that of other social sciences, predominantly in space. The most familiar method of the historians is to take their own societies as the norm and then to see how far the past is similar or different from them. This is also what an anthropologist, sociologist, or economist tends to do in the dimension of space rather than time. Further, McFarlane has quoted Popcock, who commented, "Informally, comparison is built into the method of the subject, for even in his first piece of field work, the anthropologist is comparing the categories of his own society with those of the society he studied." McFarlane has further quoted Dietrich-Klemm-Wien's work, which illustrates such a method of comparison revealed in his memoirs. As would be obvious to us by now, sociologists at different times have been aware about the problem of comparison and value judgments. How did the classical sociological thinkers and advocates of the comparative approach, like Durkheim and Weber, negotiate this? How did they manage to resolve the conflict between their commitment to the value-neutral sociology and a commitment to comparison in terms of an evolutionary progress that tactically accepted that Western societies had reached the highest stage of evolution? We discuss this in the next section, which is on the historical context of the comparative method in sociology. Before turning to the next section, it is good to keep in mind that not only had classical sociologists succumbed to the appeal of comparative method, but such thinkers as Herodotus, Aristotle, Polybius, Plutarch, among the ancient scholars, and Bodin and Machiavelli from the Renaissance had also used it. We can also draw a long list of scholars who derived inspirations from the classical sociologist application of comparative approach and gained a rich understanding of different societies and cultures. Macfarlane has included in such a list the names of Perry Anderson, Fernand Braudel, Louis Dumont, Ernest Gallinor, Jack Goody, E.L. Jones, David Landis, and William McNeill. Contemporary sociologist, for example, Andre Batley would make a case for continuing the application of the comparative method, though with due care to avoid the mistakes made by its earlier practitioners. This point of view has a lesson for us to look at the method with considerable caution and possibilities of entering into debates about various ways of using the method. Now let us wind up the session and take rest. Thank you very much for engaging yourself with a self-learning podcast.